Hey everyone, welcome to the DCMB seminar series. Today we're going to have Anshul give a talk from Stanford. Anshul's going to be talking about some of these approaches using deep learning to decode the human genome. Anshul was involved with me in the ENCODE project for a very long time. He did his PhD with Christina Leslie and then was at Stanford for a postdoc while I was there. And then went to Manolis Kellis's lab, who gave a talk here last semester, and then went back to Stanford for a faculty position there. So, looking forward to your talk.
Great. Can everyone hear me? Okay, great. So, yeah, thanks, Alan, for the kind invitation, and also all of you for being here today. It's my first time to Michigan and Ava, and seems like the weather was great, but also we had an interesting incident during lunch where the fire alarm went off. So, I'll never forget this visit for multiple reasons. So like Alan said, I started my lab around 3 years ago at Stanford. I have a joint appointment in genetics and computer science, and we've been developing machine learning methods to understand human genomes, specifically focusing on the non-coding genome. And so today, I'll talk to you about all of this is unpublished work, but feel free to get inspired and also use our code and talk to me, ask me questions. And so we've been developing these new kinds of deep learning approaches, but our goal is really not just prediction, but also interpretation. These models have been very popular in other aspects of other applications of machine learning, like computer vision, natural language processing, speech, and they have been recently applied also to problems in genomics. But they've primarily been used as a black box hammer, so basically they're very powerful predictors, so we can use them for prediction. But we're often interested in biology in terms of what patterns in the input data are responsible for our predictions. And so we've developed several interesting methods to interpret these models. And I'll go over a few sort of relevant case studies of how we use these models. And this is work done by my students and former postdoc Nathan. All right, so the main, like I mentioned before, we are really going to focus on non-coding DNA, specifically regulatory elements. And if you think about regulatory elements, typically, they are bound by context-specific transcription factors. These TFs typically have affinity for some kind of sequence elements that are encoded in non-coding elements, regulatory elements. But transcription factors, they compete with nucleosomes for access to DNA. So there's interesting regulatory effects of chromatin structure, local chromatin structure, which is a function of nucleosome occupancy and positioning. And also these nucleosomes, at least the tails of various histones, are often modified with different chemical modifications, acylations, methylations. And so we really want to sort of understand the interplay between all of these different aspects. The sequence encoding of non-coding DNA, transcription factor, context-specific transcription factor binding, chromatin accessibility, nucleosome positioning, and histone modification. So the first problem I'm going to focus on is more of a prediction problem. This is an idea of essentially how far can you get with a single assay. Okay? And our goal is to effectively try to predict a sort of combinatorial chromatin state of regulatory elements from just one single assay. So let's look into this a little bit. The classical way to approach this problem has typically been, let's just do a variety of histone chip-seq experiments in a specific cellular context of interest. Each of these histone marks, each of these chip-seq experiments capture position-specific enrichment or various histone modifications. And as you know, different combinations of modifications typically represent different classes of active and repressed elements. In this case, you have an active promoter, which is modified, which typically is associated with H3K4 trimethylation and H3K27 acylation. Here's an active enhancer, which has 27 acylation and monomethylation. Here's an active gene that has K36 trimethylation. Here's a repressed domain, polycomb repressed domain, that lacks the active marks, enriched for these repressed marks, right? You can perform these kinds of histone-specific experiments in a variety of cell types, and then you try to develop some kind of computational method that will integrate these various histone modifications and learn combinatorial states which capture these different classes of elements. One such example is, you can run a method like ChromHMM, which is a hidden Markov model, walks across the genome and learns these combinatorial chromatin states, developed by Jason Ernst and Manolis Kellis. And so, for example, if you run this on in lymphoblastoid cell lines, where you have these various kinds of data sets, various histone modifications, DNase-seq, which captures chromatin accessibility, and CTCF chip-seq. And you just enumerate, you run the chromatin algorithm, which learns 25 of these chromatin states. Each state here is one of these rows, and they capture different combinations of marks. And you see that you can decode these states and sort of figure out what they mean. They're enriched, you know, these few states are enriched for active promoters, and you have transcribed elements, enhancer-like states, CTCF states, classical heterochromatin, which is enriched for canine trimethylation, poised or bivalent states, polycomb repressed domains, and then quiescent portion of the genome that is unmodified. Okay? So each of these combinations will capture different kinds of states, active and repressed states. But the problem with this is you need several histone modifications, DNase-seq, and other kinds of experiments. And typically in rare cell populations, you still do not get enough material to do tens of 50 experiments. You still typically need several millions of cells, right? Now, if you notice one thing, if you look at DNA-seq, you can see that DNA-seq signal is highly enriched in a variety of different kinds of elements. So promoters, active promoters tend to be accessible to different degrees. Enhancers tend to be accessible to different degrees. CTCF sites, bivalent, and even repressed regions show certain amount of accessibility. So chromatin accessibility is sort of a universal signature of regulatory DNA. So what we wondered is whether there's some possibility to do one assay, like DNAs, and somehow infer the corresponding other assays that define different types of elements. Now, this sounds weird, right? How can you do this, just one assay? But let's look a little bit more in detail. So DNA-seq is also another assay that often requires several millions of cells. One such low input assay is ATAC-seq. ATAC-seq is like DNA. Instead, it uses a TN5 transposase that integrates sequencing adapters into native chromatin. So it simultaneously fragments the chromatin and inserts these adapters into it. So as you can see, the adapters are inserted, and so you get these fragments of DNA, of chromatin, where different fragments of different sizes capture different aspects of regulatory DNA. So short fragments typically capture nucleosome-free regions. Longer fragments capture nucleosomally protected DNA. And even larger fragments capture multi-nucleosomal DNA regions, right? So what you can do is then take these fragments, you can sequence them in paired end fashion, map them back to the genome, and you can count the reads, and you get really nice pileups of sequencing reads, and each of these pileups capture accessible chromatin regions. And you can do ATAC-seq, typically you get very good data from as few as 50,000 cells, but you can often go down to 5,000 cells. And now, more recently, there's single cell ATAC-seq as well. So you can effectively do ATAC-seq quite nicely in low input populations, primary cells, and so on. So it's a very powerful assay, right? You can do this in situations where you cannot do chip-seq, and that to tens of chip-seq experiments or DNA. But this just gives you like chromatin accessible elements. And now we want to have deeper annotations of what these elements actually are. Each of these peaks in the signal, are they promoters, are they enhancers, what are they active, are they repressed, what are they? Now there's an interesting source of information that you lose by simply mapping reads and counting them, okay? Which is sort of pictured right here. It's these fragment line distributions. As you can see, different fragment sizes capture different properties of chromatin, right? Short fragments capture nucleosome free, longer fragments capture nucleosome protected. So one way to look at this is if you take all the fragments in the genome that you get from an ATAC-seq experiment, and you simply plot the distribution of fragment length. So the x-axis is fragment length, y-axis is simply counting the number of fragments of each length. You see this very nice pattern, right? So you see a really nice enrichment for short fragments, which captures accessible chromatin. And then you have this nice peak, 200 base pairs, which is mononucleosomal. And then you have dinucleosomal, tri, and so on. Right? It's an exponentially decaying curve. Now, this is globally. So clearly, ATAC-seq has really interesting information about nucleosome positioning and chromatin architecture. But this is across the whole genome. Now, the whole genome is not homogeneous. We have these different types of elements. So we can do these similar kinds of plots conditioned on specific chromatin states. What I mean by that is, now let's just take all the regions in the genome that are marked as a promoter, active promoter. Yeah. This is, you would infer it, for example, let's say, from the histone modification. It's hidden, right? The marks are observed. The states are hidden, which you infer from the mark. So you can essentially take the states and you can enrich, you can use various kinds of annotations to look for enrichment, right? You know where known promoters are, right? And you can, for example, look for active promoters using RNA expression data. And you can look which of these states, which of these hidden states are highly enriched for active promoters, right? And that's how you essentially can apply these annotations. So these are manually curated annotations based on using sort of orthogonal information and looking for enrichment of orthogonal complementary information representing these different types of elements. So you can take gene bodies, right? Transcribed gene bodies. Which of these states are most enriched for transcribed gene bodies? Typically, it's these two. Right? That's how you mark them. That's how you label them. So the HMM just spits out 25 states. But this is pretty standard work. This has been done for quite a long time in the literature. Okay, so let's say we divide the genome into these different states and we take all active promoters and we plot the fragment length distribution of all active promoters. Okay, right here. And then all active enhancers, CTCF sites, bivalent states, transcribed elements, and so on. You see something really interesting. This, what you saw right here, is a global average across the whole genome. But if you split it by different chromatin states, you notice that different types of elements, in fact, have very different fragment length distribution, right? So they have some intrinsic property of chromatin architecture which biases the way the transposase integrate, right? And if you were able to, if you knew what the element was, right, if you knew it was a promoter or enhancer, you can see that in aggregate, those different types of elements have very different fragment length distribution. So could we inverse that direction, right? Let's just look at the fragment length distribution at a particular location in the genome, and then can we infer whether that region is a promoter or enhancer or suppressor. So we're just kind of reversing, assume you don't have these labels, and you want to invert the relationship. Okay. Now, this is still an interesting fragment length distribution, but it is not positionally aware. What I mean by that is, you don't care about where the fragments came from in the promoter. You just say, I'm taking a promoter region, I'm just going to take all the fragments, I'm going to count fragments of different sizes. You can do something a little more interesting, which is positionally aware fragment length distribution. These are called vplots. So here what I'm doing is I'm taking all the regions that are called as CTCF based on known labels. Okay? And I take the summits of all the ATAC-seq peaks. So all the ATAC-seq peaks that fall in a CTCF state, I take all of their summits, that is the sort of the peak region, right? And I align them. Okay? That's right here at zero. Then I go 1,000 base pairs to the left, 1,000 base pairs to the right. And now instead of simply counting reads at each position, I count reads at each position conditioned by their fragment length. Okay. So y-axis is fragment length, going from 50 base pairs to 400 base pairs. And I simply put a count. So now in this two-dimensional histogram, I'm counting fragments of specific size at each position. Okay, so I'm simply opening up the histogram, the one-dimensional histogram, into a second dimension that captures fragment length. Does that make sense? Okay. So when you do that, you actually get a really rich amount of information. Like you can clearly see short fragments enriching right at the peak summit, as you'd expect. That's where the, you know, maybe the transcription factor binds. That's the core chromatin accessible site. So there's an enrichment of short fragments there. And then you see these really nice sort of longer fragments of capturing a nucleosome, right? Sort of periodically placed around those accessible sites. Now just imagine compressing this all the way down to one dimension, right? Like we normally do, you lose all the structural information, right? You just get peaks. You don't know which peaks, which pieces of the sequence correspond to nucleosomes versus accessible sites. So the second dimension allows you to look at structural properties of DNA beyond just accessibility. But this is the aggregate vplot across some 20,000 loci. Okay, so it kind of looks nice, right? It looks like you can figure out some structure. If you look at a single CTCF site, it actually looks more like this. It's really sparse because you have a few fragments overlapping that particular region. And you can again see these pixels of counts of fragments of different sizes at each position. So we're going to take this really sparse and noisy two-dimensional vplot. We're going to try to make a prediction about whether that vplot is coming from a CTCF state or promoter state or enhancer state and so on. So if you want to translate this into a machine learning problem, it basically becomes an image classification task, right? You have sort of a two-dimensional image, a two-dimensional histogram, and each peak in the genome provides us one such example, right? Provides us one such image. It's 2,000 base pairs in length, and 40 to 300 base pairs, that's the height, right? So we have several 200,000 of these kinds of images on the genome. And in some cell types, we will have ATAC-seq data, and we will have histone modifications. So we have labeled information, right? So each of these images can now be assigned to a specific group. We can say whether it's a promoter, it's an enhancer, and so on. So you can use supervised learning to learn a function that maps these images to each of the 8 chromatin states. And then in a new cell type, we just do ATAC-seq, we apply the function, and we try to predict whether we can learn those 8 states. We can also, instead of predicting 8 states, we can also instead predict histone marks directly. We don't have to do states. If people don't like states because they're latent variables inferred by some other program, you can also just apply it directly to histone modifications and predict whether that ATAC-seq peak is associated with a histone mark or not. Does that make sense so far? Okay. So this is where we actually, this is where we turn to deep neural nets because, We tried initially a variety of different other machine learning methods. We had a hard time getting this working, primarily because it's pretty hard to understand precisely how to featureize those really sparse, crappy images. Right? It's really hard to know how to. Exactly. And this is where neural nets are really handy because you can throw in, essentially for image classification, classical computer vision tasks, you just throw in raw images of things, cats, dogs, cucumbers, whatever it is. You can throw in the raw pixel images, and the neural net can effectively induce features hierarchically, which will help you to classify non-classification of those images. Okay, so for example, when you apply these to faces, you can often see that these neural nets induce hierarchical features. The lower layers capture very elemental things like edge detectors, right? So this learning edges. The second layer learns to combine edges to create sort of more higher order shapes like, you know, eyes and nose and so on. And third and fourth layers then start putting these together into like nonlinear eigenfaces, like principal components of faces, and then you learn to combine those to actually make specific predictions. So the inherent value in pattern detection, de novo pattern detection from raw pixel images, that can potentially help us even more in this case, because unlike faces, where at least we know faces have eyes and nose and mouth and ears, I have no clue how to actually featureize those very sparse pixelated images. So we try to throw in those vplots, and we try to predict which of the chromatin states they belong to. Okay. So some basic 101 on neural nets. Maybe everyone's aware of, but if you're not, I'm just going to give you in 3 slides what a neural network actually is. It's not that deep as it sounds. In fact, the neurons are like things we know about all the time. An example of a simple linear neuron would be a bunch of inputs coming in. You just perform a linear combination, and you get an output. So a linear model is actually a linear neuron. It's a single layer, single neuron. Where you get fancy is basically you can take that output of the linear neuron and push it through some nonlinearity. The two most commonly used nonlinearities, one of which is a sigmoid, or a logistic unit. Right? So if you have a bunch of inputs coming in, you take a linear combination, and then you do a logistic transform, you're basically doing logistic regression. Right? So logistic regression is the simplest neuron, logistic neuron. Another type of, so logistic regression, the sigmoid function is a very nice function if you want to predict probabilities, because it squashes all your outputs to between 0 and 1. Right? So if you want to predict probabilities, then you want to use a logistic neuron as your final output. Another interesting nonlinearity is what's called a rectified linear unit. It's simply a thresholding function. It says anything less than 0. So if this wx plus v is less than 0, I'll keep it as is. I'll truncate it to 0. And if it's greater than 0, I'll keep it as is. It's a simple thresholding function. Okay? Now, what a neural network does is simply essentially combines both loads of these kinds of neurons into hierarchical layers. Right? So each of these neurons that are shown here can be these rectified linear unit neurons or sigmoidal neurons, and you have banks of these. Effectively, each of them can learn, think of like having boatloads of logistic regression models running in parallel, each of which is feeding to a next layer of logistic regression and so on. So they can build more and more complex functions, nonlinear functions. Effectively, they can capture any, largely capture any function that you can think of with enough training data. Now, there's a special class of neural networks called convolutional neural networks, and these are pretty powerful in situations where you have patterns that repeat themselves in the input in a position invariant manner. What I mean by that is, if you look at people's faces, right, they all have eyes and nose and mouth, but not exactly at the same position in the image. So if I move my head like this, I still have an eye or a nose and a mouth, but it's not at exactly the same position. So I want some kind of neural network where the neurons can capture basic features like eyes and nose and mouth, but not necessarily have them be at the exact same position. So one simple way to do that is to create neurons, these convolutional neurons, which operate on little patches. Okay, so think of this as an image. Each of these is a pixel. And then instead of a neuron being connected to every pixel as input, it has a local input, which is simply this little patch. Okay? So the neuron is still learning a pattern, but now what it's going to do is that same neuron is going to walk across the image one pixel at a time. Okay? And it's going to perform the same operation on each of those patches. So it can essentially think of an eye detector that you're scanning the image with. Right? So it's essentially, convolutional neuron is a scanner. It's a locally receptive neuron that scans the image looking for a specific pattern. Okay? And you don't want just one pattern, right? You want to learn many, many patterns, because your image will have lots of different patterns. So you'll have many such neurons, each of which is scanning the whole image one pixel at a time, each of which learns a unique pattern. Okay? So you'll have thousands of such neurons. So these are called convolutional filters, and these banks of neurons that capture various patterns are called convolutional layers. And you can have layer by layer, because as you can see right here, this image, when it passes through a convolutional layer, it produces another image. So you can have a second layer of convolutional filters, of convolutional neurons that operate on the output of the first one and do another scanning operation looking for higher order features and so on. You can build deep neural networks, which is simply doing pattern discovery hierarchically. Absolutely, yeah, exactly. That's right. So yeah, we have also applied these to wavelet-like transforms. Exactly. In a sense, the convolutional filters are basically doing signal processing. So that's all they're doing, right? Any questions so far? Okay. So there are other kinds of operations along with convolutions. There's also pooling operations. These operations effectively do averaging-like operations. Okay? So they will take a bunch of outputs of a bunch of neurons, and they'll say, let me take a max over these neurons, or take an average. Right? So essentially, think of it like an averaging filter that walks across a bunch of pixels and computes either a max or an average. You can see how this can be useful, because you notice how our data is really sparse, right, the image. So you might have a nucleosome, but only maybe two or three pixels fire in the nucleosome, right, because you just don't have enough sequencing power. So what you'd like to do is sort of average or take the max over like maybe a circle or a little square around that region so that you can transfer information from a pixel to its neighboring pixel, right? So pooling can give you some power in averaging and making you also spatially invariant. So here's an example of a neural network that we have that takes in a vplot and performs pooling operations, convolutions, pooling, convolutions, pooling. Then you have a bunch of fully connected neurons right here with a final output logistic neuron that predicts the class probability, that predicts whether that particular image belongs to enhancer class or promoter class. It's just a multi-class classification problem. If you only had this final layer, it would be like logistic regression, right? If it was a one-layer model with one neuron. Now you have multiple neurons, all of them performing this in hierarchy. So that's why it's a deep neural network. Now these are three inputs. You have an actual promoter, enhancer, and a pure CTCF site. And this is the raw data. This is what the actual data looks like. It's really sparse. You can barely see the pixels. Now you do some smoothing, and you can start seeing some structure pop up. So the first layer does a pooling operation. You can see like accessible sites with some nucleosomes trying to pop up. Here's the promoter, here's the enhancer. If you jump all the way to the second set of convolutional maps, these are the transformed images as they pass through these filters, right? You can start seeing some interesting things happening. Like this filter right here seems to be homing in more on the accessible site, right? So it's masking out the nucleosomes and focusing more on the accessible site. And each of these filters are doing very interesting transformations on the input to produce, to highlight different features. And just like I showed you in the case of the face images, right? Something's capturing a nose and a mouth. Similarly, here the filters are trying to capture different aspects of the images. Yeah. So we have similar models that are also trying to predict. Exactly. So there you have two loci coming into the inputs, and you're trying to predict whether they interact or not. And we have some models for that. I won't be talking about that today, but this is more looking at cis effects, or like proximal effects. So that was how you take ATAC-seq and effectively induce these labels out of that. But you can do the same thing for other kinds of inputs too. So let's assume you don't have ATAC-seq, but you actually have DNase and MNA-seq, right? Each of which captures separately accessible DNA, accessible chromatin, and nucleosomal chromatin, right? So you could do an MNA-seq assay that captures nucleosome positioning, a DNA-seq assay that captures accessible chromatin. Both of these are typically considered as 1D assays because they usually use single end sequencing, so you don't actually have fragment length to leverage. So these are just like one-dimensional histograms. Now, if you want to integrate these two, you can actually build what are called multi-modal convolutional neural nets. But effectively, like I showed you before, now instead of a 2D image, you just have a 1D input, right? A 1D vector. And then you have two such 1D vectors, MNAs and DNAs. And then you have separate convolution layers running on each of these separately. And in higher layers, what you do is you take the outputs of these convolutions and you concatenate them. Okay? And then the next layer has neurons that connect to the outputs of the convolution layers coming out from DNAs and the convolution layers coming out from MNAs. So what they're able to do is integrate information at the higher level across the two types of inputs. Right? And so they do essentially data integration for free. That's right. So yes, you can also multi-channel them. That's what you're saying, right? So you're saying just basically have MNAs as one channel, DNAs another channel. So you have like a two-channel input. We've tried that too. The difference is that, in fact, I'll show you the next model. We throw in sequences as well, DNA sequence, so we can essentially integrate all kinds of things. The thing is, the scale of the features are different often in different input modalities. So when that happens, you actually want sort of convolutional filters to adapt to different scales. And it tends to work better if you actually have them as separate modes than as multiple channels. So just to give you an example of what a 1D convolution looks like, just like in 2D, you have little patches running around the image. Here you have little 1D patterns, which actually capture like little shape, basic units of shape, right? Like imagine you have a little spike in the DNase data, a little valley in the DNase data. And so here's an example of one such shape. The act of convolution is simply taking this shape and then scanning this profile and looking for good matches. So this shape exactly matches this position. You get a high score, you get low scores everywhere else. And you have many such shape detectors. They capture different patterns. And you simply scan them. And they give you a next layer of data where you can apply a second order convolutional filter that now integrates different shapes to learn higher order patterns. Same idea as the face example I gave you, right? Combine eyes and nose and put them together, create faces. Except here it's like little patterns of footprints and some peaks and troughs. It learns all of this on the fly. So you don't have to pre-specify these features. These are just weights in the neural network. Neural network learns these data. Okay? You can do the same thing for sequence. Your sequence can be represented as a one-hot encoding with four channels, A, C, B, and T, with a one or a zero corresponding to which nucleotide is present at which position. And now your convolutional filters, your little patches that are running around the sequence, are of size 4 by L. They just have weights in them. And you can visualize these. They basically are like PWMs, right? Position weight matrices, like 4 by L. So effectively, convolutional filters on DNA sequence are learning motif-like detectors. But unlike motifs which are one, like a single layer, you can scan these sequences with these motifs, get scores, and now you can have convolutional filters on top of this first order layer, which now combine different motifs, so they can learn higher order patterns, right? Like combinations of motifs with specific spacing, orientation, and so on. So you can learn much more complex patterns by simply adding more layers, and you can learn higher order combinations. So you can put this all together, we call this the computer. You can integrate essentially these 2D and the like images, you can integrate them with 1D stuff, integrate those with sequence, and you can effectively learn features from all of these at de novo from the raw data, and then high order layers that effectively do the integration. And instead of predicting just one output, you can also predict multiple outputs at the same time. So imagine, like in our case, we wanted to predict different histone modifications, right? You could certainly learn one classifier for each histone modification, but we know that histone modifications share information, where they often come together. So the same feature should be important for them, right, for different histone modifications. So the idea is, in a final layer, instead of having one output, which is a logistic function, logistic neuron predicting one histone mark, you have separate neurons, each of which are simultaneously predicting different histone marks. Okay? So the whole model shares the basic feature construction, but then the final layer learns how to weight these features differently to predict different histone marks. Okay? The power of it is you're sharing information, so you're able to learn much more robust models with less data. Okay, so enough of theory for now. Hopefully you understand how neural networks. Yes. Correct. That's right. Because there's a label. Yeah. There's also interesting ways to make this unsupervised. Like, you can have the output be the input. And in that sense, the neural network actually does what's called an encoding. You can effectively learn like a bottleneck, a bunch of neurons that learn to encode the data, the input data, into a much more compact representation such that it can reproduce the output. And those representations are often actually very useful for other kinds of prediction tasks. So you can just essentially do this as an integrative compression of data and then use it for everything else. But this is, in this case, it's supervised. So that's neural networks 101. As you can see, it's not that complicated. You train these models using classical approaches like stochastic gradient descent, which are commonly used methods for logistic regression. The same sort of ideas apply. You're just using them in more complicated ways with slightly better optimization. So you're learning all the weights which effectively induce all of these features. So let's look at some results. I'm going to walk you through this table. So the first line, remember, it's an 8-class classification problem. We're going to talk about the chromatin state prediction problem first, where we have these 8 types of states, right? Promoter, enhancer, transcribed, CTCF, repressed, and a bunch of others. And I'll show you those in a second. So the baseline would be the majority class, right? So the majority class covers 42% of the example. So if you are a dumb classifier that just used the bias in the data, you would get 42% accuracy. That's the baseline. If you use gene proximity as your only feature, like clearly if you use gene proximity, you could figure out genes and promoters pretty well, right? And maybe say that, okay, anything that's not a promoter or a gene is likely an enhancer. If you just do that, you get jump to 60%. So a really simple classifier actually does 60%. The baseline is not 0 or 50, it's 60%. So that's where you're starting off. Now, if you take a classical machine learning method like random forest with ATAC-seq, right, with the 2D images that I showed you, you only get 61%. So if you use a classical machine learning method that directly worked on the pixel data, right, it cannot go very far. It just gets like 2% better than gene proximity. So clearly, it's almost like there is no information. Let's use computer with DNAs. So by that I mean one-dimensional DNAs. There's no fragmented information, right? It's just a classical one-dimensional track. you already get a 7% boost. So as soon as you switch to a neural network with loss of information, meaning you're not having any fragmental information, this simple modeling, you know, the pattern of DNA's cuts, you actually still do get to 68.1%. And if you do it for MNAs and keep an eye on the numbers of reads, 60 million reads for DNAs, 1.5 billion for MNAs, right? So that's a much, much bigger sequencing depth. You get about the same. So what this indicates is that DNAs and MNAs are like mirror images of each other in some sense, right? Because one captures the accessible part, the other captures the nucleosome. They both have kind of the same information. If you throw them into a neural network, you actually get pretty much the same accuracy, okay? But ATAC-seq, which is sort of combining them, both of them, in this two-dimensional space where you have accessibility and nucleosome positioning jointly encoded, you can see you get a massive jump, right? DNAs and MNAs alone gave you 68 to 69, and ATAC in the two-dimensional form, put through a neural network, gives you 75.9. So that's a pretty large jump right there. Now, if you combine DNAs and MNAs, they reinforce each other, and in some sense, they have more signal to noise compared to ATAC, and so you get a still a nice boost, 75.9 to 81.6. If you combine ATAC-seq plots with sequence information, you get 83.5. Your DNAs plus MNAs plus sequence, you get 86.2. Okay, so that's as high as we can go, 86.2. And so our lower bound was 42%. That's like a random classifier. And what's our upper bound? So is our upper bound 100%? Well, we're looking at chromatin states, which are inferred by this HMM. So we can do two replicates of the same data set. We can train an HMM on one replicate, apply it to the other, and look at how often amongst replicates we get the state wrong. That error rate is about 12%. Okay, so the upper bound on accuracy, just based on the labeling noise, is about 88%. So we're just about 2% short of that. So we kind of max this out, right? Yeah. Yeah. Of course. Yeah. Right. Yeah, so that's the reason the error rate is about 12%, right? If it was probably manually curated, I don't think anyone can manually curate the whole genome. So, sure. So just wait for my next slide, because I often get this criticism, so I have another slide to take that away. Just hold on for a second. But I agree with you. So both of your points are very important. These are very valid points. The first is the prediction I'm showing you is cross-validation. Yeah, that means I'm holding out some chromosomes, and I'm predicting the labels in those chromosomes. That's a useless effort, because in reality, I want to predict in a new cell type, correct? And the second thing is, the states that I have are generated by an HMM. So who knows, right, what they are. So let me try to address both of those points, both of which are very valid. So the first way to address that is, let's just go back to the real data. We don't need states. We have marks. We have the actual marks, right? I can actually show you the accuracy on individual marks directly. So now I'm not using any computational tool. I'm actually looking at the data. I'm simply labeling each ATAC-seq peak as whether it is associated with this useful mark or not, right? So that level, this is the area under the precision recall curve. And you can see for most of these active marks that are associated with active chromatin, our AUPRCs are close to 0.95, 0.96. So we're essentially like completely solving the problem right there. Okay, where we effectively do pretty poorly is these marks, K36, K27, and K9 trimethyl. This is mostly a data problem. So we have a few hundred peaks, okay, that fall in these kinds of regions. So actually, we don't have enough training data to accurately classify different classes of repressed chromatin against active. But once we're in the active domain, we can exactly tell you which histone modifications mark which accessible site. Okay? So that should hopefully address your issue with fancy labeling. So what I showed you in the multitask output is chromatin state is one task, and all the other marks are also the other task, right? So there's nice sharing of information across the task, and that helps a bit. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we have to do task-specific weighting, and there are various tricks to actually get this working right. And also there are ways in which you can, like the architecture I showed you is a very simple one, which is just effectively splitting apart at the last layer. But we have found more interesting architectures where you split early for some kind of problem. You pre-train on the chromatin states first, and then you hold off the other tasks, you pre-train on the chromatin states, and then you add in the other tasks, and you get this. So there are curriculum sort of strategies of training the model that often do better than just letting it run. Okay, so this addresses the issue potentially of having the chromatin states versus histone marks. This is the real data, so we can actually predict that pretty well as well. So getting to your other important question of, does it actually work across cell types? So that's the whole point. So here's an example of where we have two reasonably different cell types. One is a lymphoblastoid cell line, and the other is a leukemia line. Okay, just to tell you how different they are, if we take the chromatin states and we map them over, we just copy them over from one cell type to the other, the accuracy of that is 56%. Okay, so they're not just like very similar, they're actually very different. We just copy over states from lymphoblastoids into the leukemia line, and look at that accuracy, it's about 56%. So here what I'm showing you is training on one cell line and predicting on a different cell line. Okay, this is if you train and predict on the same cell line. You can see across the board, even for cross-cell type prediction, there is not much loss in accuracy. In fact, it's pretty much the same. This makes a lot of sense, right? And the reason is because we know histone modifications are universally mapped across cell types. So enhancer is marked the same way in one cell type versus another cell type. Where enhancer occurs changes, of course. But the definition of enhancer, like basically association with specific histone modifications, is consistent. DNA sequence, on the other hand, is actually a really bad predictor if you want to go cross cell types. Because the transcription factors that drive enhancers in specific cell types are highly cell type specific, right? But the what the model is showing is that the architectures they produce are actually universal. They transfer across cell types just like histone modifications do. So we're computationally sort of supporting the idea that histone modifications are likely maintaining a canonical architecture for different types of elements. And the neural network can actually learn these architectures, these canonical architectures, directly from the ATAC-seq block. Okay? Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. There's nothing else done on the test set. So now we're doing this on 7 or 8 different cell types. And actually, we've got good results across the board. So you can, for example, train on embryonic stem cells, and you can predict in lymphoblastoid lines. This is like no comparison. At least these are like bloodlines, so you might say, okay, well, they're sort of similar. But you can go to extremely different corners of the world, of the anatomical world, and you can still get very nice cross-cell type prediction. So basically what we're showing is with one assay, like a ATAC-seq, deeply sequenced, which is about 150 million reads, with the vplot representation and a powerful neural network algorithm that can induce features de novo, you can essentially tag accessible sites with higher level annotations of what the modifications of sites contain. All right, so let me jump to the next problem, which is similar, except now instead of predicting chromatin states, we want to predict transcription factor binding sites, the in vivo transcription factor binding events. So why is this important? Because we cannot do chip-seq for hundreds of transcription factors in hundreds of cell types, simply infeasible. So we need an ability to essentially infer VF binding in new cell types. So we again model this as a simple binary classification task where we have chip-seq data in some training cell type, in this case, for example, nanog, and the positive examples are chip-seq peaks of the TF. We take the underlying 1.5 kb sequence. The negative set, this is really important, and I'll get to this in a second. The negative set spans a broad, is actually the rest of the genome. Right? So technically, the rest of the genome is not bound by the TF. You need to be able to discriminate the positive set from the negative set. So we have interesting case to sample the negative set genome, which is like we use all other chromatin accessible sites, GC matched regions, flanking sequences, and sequences sampled from various chromatin states. So we sample the genome in interesting ways. And then the question is, can we predict in vivo binding in new cell types, okay, using a model that's trained on reference cell types? So we go back to computer, the same idea. And now we have DNAs and sequence. And instead of predicting different histone modifications, we try to predict different transcription factor binding sites, okay, based on chip-seq data. Now this is really important because the way we're evaluating this data is completely different from practically every other method published in the literature. Okay? Everyone does cross-validation largely, kind of like what the point you raised. They will effectively hold out some chromosomes, they will train a model, and then they'll make predictions, and they will use area under the RNA curve to measure how well they're doing. Okay? Now everyone knows that there's a basic fundamental issue with AUROC. Can you tell me what that is? That's right. So AUROC is effectively immune to class imbalance. Okay? It doesn't matter because it's looking at false positive rates and true positive rates. In a prediction problem for the genome, typically any prediction problem you think about, less than 1% of your examples are positive. Okay? So that's a super unbalanced prediction problem. And your baseline AUROC can end up being very, very high, even though your actual performance is terrible. So just to give you an example, here are two deep neural network models. This is DeepBind, published in 2015, the first neural network model that was used for predicting TF binding. It was in Nature Biotech. Here are their AUROCs, here are our AUROCs. And note that we are predicting this AUROC in a new cell type in new chromosome, okay, held out chromosome. So we're predicting a new cell type on chromosomes we never used in training. You can't just copy OOP, right? That would be an easy strategy to potentially impute binding. You need a functional model of that. You can see that both methods effectively get AUROCs in the 0.9 range. So we should pack our bags and go home. We're done, right? Except when you look at actually area under the precision recall curve, you see a very different story, right? Firstly, we are way better than deep bind. So each, just to give you, each point here is a transcription factor. It's just showing you the relative AUROCs and AUPRCs. And also you can see a big spread compared to this, which shows that everything is doing well. Now, AUPRC is still also not actually a good measure because it's integrating over the entire precision recall curve, right? But you may be interested in your recall at a specific false discovery rate. Like typically you fix your FDR to 10% or 20%, and then you say, what's my recall? So that's what you want to guarantee if you're actually doing prediction. Let's do that. This is what you get. So DBind basically has close to zero recall for every transcription factor at a 10% FDR. I'm not picking on DBind. Replace DBind with any method that you have in the literature, any. Name it. Put it in there. They're all in the same situation. At any reasonable FDR, 10, 15, 20, 25, 50, 50% FDR, most of them are actually close to zero. Okay? Our method, you can see, is actually doing much better, but clearly we haven't solved the problem. So there's a lot of work to do before we claim that we've replaced chip-seq data, right? But clearly there's actually dramatic improvement. And there are two reasons why. The first important reason is the negative set matters. How you train your model matters a lot. You can't just sample locations from the genome as a negative set and build a classifier. The genome is not random. There are different, there's very interesting heterogeneity in properties of genomic sequences, and so you need to sample the negatives properly. Second thing is, so just as in the chromatin state problem, like I mentioned, transcription factors, even though their core binding sites are similar, identical across cell types, that is the sequence affinity of the transcription factor is the same, irrespective of cell type. The cofactors it binds with are entirely cell type dependent. So actually sequence is your worst predictor if you want to generalize across cell types. Okay? The more you model sequence in your training cell types, the worse you will do in your test cell type. Because you're effectively learning properties of the training cell type. So just to give an example, maybe in erythroid cells, like GATA1 is primarily driving the chromatin landscape. Like there's a pioneer factor that kicks in and really defines the landscape. Right? And all these other factors bind with it. Maybe when you switch to liver, HNF4A drives the chromatin landscape, and all these other factors bind with HNF4A. So if you train your model for, let's say, Jundi or some other transcription factor in erythroid cells, you will learn all these beautiful patterns of GATA1 coming with Jundi, right, motif. You transfer it over to the liver, it does something completely wrong. So you need methods that can actually adapt to the fact that training and test cell type are not from the same distribution. This breaks typical assumptions of machine learning, right? Where training and test cell type are coming from the same distribution, just train your model on the training cell type, apply to the test cell type, and you'll do fine. That breaks here. And so there are many tricks that we have to get around that. We also ran this dream challenge, which recently ended, and actually Yuanfang Guan, who's at the University of Michigan, she jointly won the challenge with another team. And she realized this idea, and people applied all kinds of crazy machine learning methods to this problem. They applied extensive feature engineering, and the teams who engineered sequence more and more did worse and worse. That's right. So what Yuanfang did is she realized, I think, this, and she just took the canonical motif of that transcription factor. She just takes only the motif of that TF, and although that's a suboptimal approach, because you're not modeling cofactor events, it is by far a better approach than overfitting to the training cell type. So with one motif, she destroys methods that effectively throw neural nets with thousands of different feature engineer, like sequence features engineers. Just give you an example of how thinking about the problem is actually extremely important, as much as it is to throw a fancy machine learning method at it. And we'll have some interesting results coming out of the challenge in the next few months. So do I have some more time, Alan? Is there a lot of time? Okay. Maybe another 15 minutes? Or is that too much? Okay. Yeah. All right. So I went through some prediction examples, and now I want to just show you how we can interpret these models. And for doing that, there are essentially two approaches to interpret models. One of which is now let's say I give you a neural network that predicts these TFs, right? There are two things I can do. One is what's called in silico mutagenesis. So I can effectively mutate each nucleotide in the sequence, propagate the effect to the output, and see the effect it has, right? So if I have important nucleotides, if I mutate them, they will actually have significant effects on the output. This is a classical strategy that's used, but it's extremely slow, and actually it has several issues with it. So another approach that we have is essentially these backpropagation approaches. They take the output, and they decompose hierarchically. So think about predicting GATA1, and you can exactly, for this particular input sequence, you can know by looking at the weights and the gradients as they pass through the network, you can infer the relative contribution of each of the neurons in the penultimate layer. You can propagate that down further back down, all the way down to the sequence itself, right? So you get essentially an important score for every nucleotide in the input, okay? So our method is called deep lift. Here's the code for it. So I'm going to skip this because I want to show you some interesting examples of So we want to apply this idea to a situation where we don't care about prediction, but we care about interpretation. And that is actually looking at hematopoietic differentiation, where we have ATAC-seq data and various hematopoietic cell types. And we want to understand how sequence is driving cell type specific accessibility maps. So we apply this neural network which takes in sequence of all the accessible sites and tries to predict whether they are open or not in each of these different cell types using a multitask neural network. Okay, so the input is again sequence, and we're simply trying to predict is the sequence open or not, accessible or not in each of these cell types. So we get high prediction accuracy. You can see our AUPRC is 0.65, AURRC is 0.82. So the model is learning, but you don't care about the prediction because what we care about is we already have the data. We want to infer what in the sequence is driving the data. So I'll skip this part, but just go to like case studies of specific enhancers. So here's a really cool enhancer. It is accessible in HSCs, but not in B cells. It has these three, these collections of motifs, three GATA motifs, and one SPI1 motif. You want to understand how these are used in specific context to give rise to differential accessibility. So if you look at what's happening in HSCs, you can see that the neural network effectively is suppressing the GATA motif, and only picking out SPI1, right? So we know GATA is not expressed in HSEs, so it makes sense that GATA should not show up as a predictive feature when we look at the same enhancer in the HSE task. Okay? If you take the same enhancer and switch it to the B cells, it suppresses all the motifs, saying that, okay, that enhancer is not active. Okay? So this is an easy case because the enhancer is active in one cell type and inactive in another cell type. What about a case when the enhancer is actually active in both cell types? So let's go back to the same enhancer. It in fact is active in HSCs and in erythroid cells. Okay? Now when you apply the importance scoring method, which propagates the importance back down the sequence, again, as before, in HSCs, we predict that this enhancer is being driven by SPI1. But in erythroid cells, it is being jointly driven by the three GATA motifs and SPI1. So we're taking the same sequence and we're getting conditional activation of nucleotides, depending on which cell type we look at, giving us context-specific transcription factors that drive that element. So this is very different because these are not differentially accessible sites. This is the same element that is accessible in two cell types, but it is being driven by different transcription factors. Right? In one case, GATA1, and in the other case, GATA1 with SPI1. And here you can see we have specific evidence of this. And I'll skip this, but we can effectively do this on a large scale, and we're able to effectively infer for multiple transcription factors, we see extensive evidence of differential reuse of the same DNA sequence. So the same DNA sequence is an accessible site in multiple cell types, but it is being made accessible by different combinations of TF. And the neural network, when combined with this interpretation approach that propagates the prediction back down to the sequence, allows us to infer which exact nucleotides are driving, or which combinations of nucleotides and motifs are driving specific activation patterns in different cell types. It's a very powerful strategy for understanding context-specific use of DNA sequence. So I'll just stop there. We have other types of inputs that we can analyze. And I just want to give you some, I'm not going to summarize, but I want to give you some of the lessons we've learned from the last 2 years of sort of how to use these deep neural network models. The first lesson is the negative background set really matters. You need to think carefully about setting up the classification problem and how you sample the genome, right? We think about this very carefully in statistical genetics. We think about backgrounds all the time. In more classical machine learning approaches to computational genomics, the background is often ignored. You just randomly sample the background in the hope for the best. How you model the negative background really makes a difference. We should be training and testing models on unbalanced data and reporting performance on unbalanced data on the whole genome. If your goal is to predict on the whole genome, and report your accuracies on the whole genome using metrics, not like AUROC, that are actually sensitive to class imbalance. So they give much more realistic estimates of how well you're doing. There is no such thing as a default architecture. You really have to, don't just take default methods and models that people build and apply them to your problem. You can always get better performance and better models by fine-tuning architectures. There are interesting ways to actually utilize prior knowledge. So you can actually seed these models with known motifs and let them evolve so they can actually use biological prior knowledge. There are various ways to augment data. So in situations where you don't have enough data, you can do interesting approaches like you can take the same sequence and jitter it. You can just kind of move it around and you can generate artificial inputs that can effectively enhance prediction. Always learn multiple models by changing various parameters, you know, changing window sizes, doing cross-validation, and then look for interpretation features and prediction that is an ensemble of these different models. You get much more reliable predictions if you focus on some combinational models, and you even get much more reliable interpretation if you look for patterns that recurrently occur when you perturb models in slightly different ways. And so with that, I'll just stop and thank my lab. These are students who've really done the work. Rahul's high school student who also worked with us. A lot of the ATAC-seq stuff was done in collaboration with Will. And this is work funded by ENCODE, Roadmaps, Sloan Foundation, and the NIST innovator. So yeah, with that, thanks. And in case you're interested in learning about neural networks, we have a really nice tutorial. It's a web-based tutorial that runs on the cloud. It's designed for people who know and may not know programming. You don't need to actually set up any software. Just go here, They're very sort of user-friendly IPython notebooks that allow you to play with architectures of various kinds of deep neural networks for genomics. We also have code that you can use for various problems. Okay, thanks a lot.
Time for a couple of questions.
Independent test set, you use held out cell type, but still use for the same genomic region you use in training.
No. It's held out cell type, held out chromosome.
Okay, so this is new chromosome. All right. The second question is, in your title, there's like interpretable deep learning. So why do you think your model is more interpretable than other deep learning models?
Yeah, I mean, I think what we're able to do is precisely take the model, and we're able to take any specific input, right? Like I showed you in this example, this specific enhancer, and we're able to tell you precisely, we can do this for every enhancer in the genome, right? We can take every enhancer in the genome in every cell type, to train the model on, and we can infer what in the sequence is driving the prediction, right? So that's allowing us to interpret what in the sequence is actually allowing us to make those predictions. And they are clearly biologically meaningful combinatorial interactions of transcription factor binding events. We also have ways to actually interpret the model itself. I didn't have time to get into that, but there are ways to actually extract global patterns that the model is learning across a large collection of inputs. So effectively, our goal is not just to make predictions, right, which is just looking at the outputs, but to also understand what in the input is actually, in some sense, causing or predicting the output. And the power of these multitask models is you can switch, you can take the same input and switch the cell type or the condition, and you can actually obtain nucleotide resolution prediction of what actually is driving the input. It's very different from like just using, let's say, known motifs and you know, using those as naive features. Because we can get nucleotide level importance and differential usage in different cell types or different conditions. We've also done the similar things on vplots, so we can actually interpret what in the vplot is actually driving a prediction. You can learn these specific nucleosomes, that nucleosomal positioning properties that are specific to promoters and enhancers and so on. So you can apply this to any kind of input. It doesn't have to be sequence. Right? The examples I showed you were primarily sequence, but you can apply them to the vplots, to the DNase profiles. So you can learn footprints for transcription factors, various other kinds of interpretation of the input. Yes. Yeah, absolutely. So one such example would be, like I mentioned, the autoencoders, right? So you can take all these sequences, let's say for enhancers and promoters, right, that you have, and your goal is to learn an interesting sort of encoding of that information that's present in them. So think of predicting a sequence from the same sequence, right? So you have sequence going in, you have a bunch of neurons, the output is predicting the same sequence. You have a bottleneck that learns some kind of nonlinear combination of how nucleotides contribute to each other to give rise to the same sequence. Now, what you can do is think of that like almost like doing PCA on sequences, right? Like if you have lots of large, high-dimensional data, typically if you want to do some kind of clustering or visualization, you would try to project it into a lower-dimensional space and then look at patterns in that space. So the encoding that you can get from a neural network can also give you similar low-dimensional encoding, except a nonlinear encoding. PCA is a linear encoding, right? So you have a nonlinear dimensionality reduction, and then you can use that as sort of a new feature vector for that example. And you can now observe, you can look for clustering structure visualization in that latent space. So that can give you pretty powerful ways to also do things in unsupervised ways. Any other questions?
Yeah, I think that's good. Let's thank Anshul again. That was really great.